In yesterday's class, we mainly discussed about the major types of waves and also electromagnetic waves and Maxwell's research on Ampere circuital law and Maxwell Ampere equation we have already discussed yesterday. Today, let me start class with the topic source of electromagnetic waves. Dear children, you all know that source of a wave may be different in different kinds of waves. For example, if you see sound wave, source of a sound wave is any vibrating body can produce sound. That propagates in the form of wave from the point of disturbance to the other points. But in case of these electromagnetic waves, already we know electromagnetic waves are the waves that can travel in vacuum, that can travel in a free space without any material medium. But we discussed wave is nothing but disturbance created in medium. But in case of electromagnetic waves, there is no medium. But what disturbance is being propagated in the form of electromagnetic wave, and what will be the source of electromagnetic wave? Now let us see. Here is charges neither stationary nor charges in uniform motion can be source of electromagnetic wave. Neither charges stationary nor charges in uniform motion can be source of electromagnetic wave. It means charges stationary charges and charges in uniform motion, this both cannot produce an electromagnetic wave, because a charged body or a charge which is at a stationary position, means which is at the state of rest, can only have electric field around itself. And if you see the charges in uniform motion, I think you know very well the meaning of uniform motion. Uniform motion means if a body moves with constant velocity without fluctuations in the velocity, then we do say that is uniform motion. Here, in this situation, charges in uniform motion, charges those which are moving without any change in the velocity or with a zero acceleration, both kinds, neither charges stationary nor charges in uniform motion, both cannot be source of electromagnetic wave. It means these two kinds of charges cannot produce electromagnetic wave, because A stationary charge can only produce the magnetic electric field. A charge which is moving in uniform motion can only produce the magnetic field, but in electromagnetic field there are two fields, electric field and magnetic field. That's why this both cannot be sources of electromagnetic wave. But only accelerated charges radiate energy in the form of electromagnetic wave. So it is the source of an EM wave, electromagnetic wave. That charges in stationary position, charges are in uniform motion, cannot produce electromagnetic wave. But charges in accelerated motion, means charges which are moving with varying velocity, can produce or can release electromagnetic radiation. So sources of electromagnetic wave is nothing but accelerated charges. Accelerated charges can produce electromagnetic wave. It means to see an electromagnetic wave, there must be an accelerated charges, means electric charges must be in acceleration, then only electromagnetic wave can be produced. An oscillating charge produces an oscillating electric field in space, which produces an oscillating magnetic field. An oscillating or an accelerating charge produces an oscillating or accelerating electric field. And we know very well in the previous lessons, an accelerating or an oscillating or changing electric field can produce magnetic field. The oscillating electric and magnetic fields regenerate each other and propagate through free space as waves are called electromagnetic waves. It means if there is a accelerating charge, then it can produce accelerating electric field. That accelerating electric field can produce accelerating magnetic field, and that accelerating or varying electric and magnetic field together propagate in the form of a electromagnetic wave. And an electric charge oscillating harmonically with frequency f produces electromagnetic wave of frequency f, same frequency f. It means if an electric charge is oscillating with a particular frequency f, and the electromagnetic wave produced by that oscillating electric charge also with the same frequency f, and this is about the source of electromagnetic wave. Finally, we conclude that the source of electromagnetic wave is the oscillating charges, oscillating charge. A oscillating charge can produce oscillating electric field. An oscillating electric field can produce oscillating magnetic field, and both together propagate in a direction which is nothing but electromagnetic wave. Now let us see how that electric field and magnetic field vary in case of electromagnetic wave. See here, properties of electromagnetic wave. So this is the diagram which is representing how electric field and magnetic field are varying whenever the electromagnetic wave is propagating from one point to another point. Here there are three axes perpendicular to each other are taken: x-axis, y-axis and z-axis. In this representation, this origin is the point of source or point of disturbance where the electromagnetic wave is generating, and the direction OX along the positive X direction, there is the direction of propagation of electromagnetic wave, and variation in electric field is represented on Y axis. This is the variation of electric field shown on Y axis, and variation in magnetic field represented along the Z axis. So this one, variation in both electric and magnetic fields occur simultaneously. Therefore, they attain their maxima and minima at the same place and at same time. I hope you know the meaning of maxima and minima. Maxima means whenever there are two or more waves simultaneously incident on any particular point, the maximum displacement they reached called maxima, minimum displacement they reached is called minima. So in this electromagnetic waves, there are two fields called electric field and magnetic field simultaneously occur, and simultaneously at a particular time they will change in the particular time, but they reach the maximum displacement and minimum displacement at the same times. The direction of electric and magnetic fields are mutually perpendicular to each other, and as well as the direction of propagation of wave. We can see here the direction of propagation of waveform is from O to X, we considered in this diagram, and the change in electric field is along Y axis, change in electric and magnetic fields mutually perpendicular to each other. And you see the angle between this Y axis and Z axis is 90 degrees. That's why here the change in magnetic field and electric field both are perpendicular to each other, and both also perpendicular to the direction of propagation of wave. Direction of propagation of wave is along X axis, and direction of change of electric field is along Y axis, and direction of change of magnetic field is along Z axis. Then all these three axes are mutually perpendicular. That's why we can say simply, in electromagnetic wave there are two fields called electric field and magnetic field, and this is this curve is, this wave is representing change in electric field like this, and this curve is representing change in magnetic field. In this way there is change in magnetic field, and both are changing in a direction perpendicular to each other and also perpendicular to the direction of propagation of wave. So this is electromagnetic wave and its representation. Next, the electric field vector E and magnetic field vector R B are related, C equal to E naught by B naught, where E naught and B naught are amplitudes of respective fields and C is speed of light. So E naught is nothing but amplitude of the electric fields wave, and B naught is nothing but amplitude of this magnetic fields wave, and amplitude is nothing but, we can say that the maximum displacement or height of the waveform for electric field here to here, this will be the amplitude, and for magnetic field this will be the amplitude, and this expression shows the relation between E naught and B naught, means between the electric fields amplitude and magnetic fields amplitude, and C is speed of light, you know very well that is 3 into 10 to the power of 8 meter per second. Next, the velocity of electromagnetic waves in free space can be determined by using a formula. C is equals to 1 by square root of mu naught into epsilon naught. Mu naught stands for permeability of free space. Epsilon naught stands for the permittivity of free space. Then by taking this ratio, we can get the speed of light in free space, that is C is equals to, that is approximately equal to the speed of light in vacuum, 3 × 10⁸ meter per second. The velocity of electromagnetic waves in a metallic medium is 1 by square root of mu into epsilon, where mu and epsilon are the permeability and permittivity of the medium respectively. Here the difference between this expression C equal to 1 by square root of mu naught into epsilon naught and here 1 by square root of mu into epsilon, there is mu naught and epsilon naught, here is mu and epsilon is nothing but subscript zero representing the free space. And mu and epsilon, these are the values of that particular medium where the electromagnetic wave is propagating. Electromagnetic waves obey the principle of superposition. I think you know very well about the principle of superposition that you have seen in the lesson wave optics. Principle of superposition. According to the principle of superposition, whenever two or more waves simultaneously incident on any point of the medium or any particle of the medium, the displacement of that particle will be equal to the algebraic sum of the displacements of all waves. Means if there are two waves incidenting on a particular particle of a medium with two different amplitudes, and the resultant displacement of that particular point in the medium will be equal to the vector sum of amplitudes of that two waves. And here the same principle is obeyed by the electromagnetic waves. Two or more electromagnetic waves, if they simultaneously incident on any one particular point of medium, then their displacement will be, resultant displacement of particle will be equal to the vector sum of displacements of individual waves incidenting on that particular point. Electromagnetic waves carry energy as they propagate through space. This energy is divided equally between electric and magnetic fields. It means here it can cause electric effects and magnetic effects equally. Electromagnetic waves can transfer energy as well as momentum of object placed on their path. It means whenever this electromagnetic wave incident on any one particular object, then their energy can be transferred to that particular object. If the frequency and wavelength of that electromagnetic wave incidenting is of energy which is equal to the body's, that particular body's energy, then it can also give momentum to that body. For discussion of optical effects of electromagnetic wave, more significance is given to electric field E, therefore electric field is called light vector. As there is a electromagnetic wave is a combination of electric field and magnetic field, they can give magnetic effects and electric effects, and this electromagnetic waves also give some effects, optical effects. But that optical effects purely depends on the electric field of the electromagnetic wave. That's why that electric field of the electromagnetic wave is called light vector. Electromagnetic wave do not require material medium to travel. An oscillating charge which has non-zero acceleration can produce electromagnetic wave. This point, what we have discussed in a previous slide, the oscillating charge can only produce an electromagnetic wave. Oscillating charge or accelerating charge is nothing but non-zero acceleration charge. Means a charge which is moving, oscillating with some particular acceleration, not zero, that is not zero, can produce electromagnetic wave. And now, let us see the Hedge experiment, which is performed by the scientist Hedge to recognize the presence of electromagnetic wave by his experiment. And here it is given, the experimental setup performed by Hedge. And in this experimental setup, you can see here is a copper or zinc plate. Both copper or zinc plates are arranged parallel to each other. And here is a metallic rod, which is in contact with a small sphere S1. And here too, there is a metallic rod, which is connected to a small sphere S2. And both are separated with a very small distance. And these two metallic rods are connected to induction coil, which can produce potential difference between S1 and S2. And all this arrangement setting is kept before a ring in which there are two spheres S1 dash and S2 dash. And now let us discuss working of this system. And here the copper or zinc plates are kept parallel, separated by 60 centimeter. The metal spheres are slid over the metal rods to have a gap of 2 to 3 centimeter. Induction coil supplies high voltage of several thousand volts. Here this is induction coil, and this induction coil can produce high voltage. Means when it produces high voltage, there will be more potential difference between S1 and S2. And the plates and the rods with the spheres constitute an LC combination. LC combination means this is a inductor capacitor combination. Mainly this LC combination we use to generate a single frequency signals, and also we use this LC combination of circuits to filter or to receive a particular frequency signals. These two metal plates also connected to LC combination. And then an open metallic ring of a diameter 0.7 meter having small metallic spheres acts as detector. It means here this part of the ring will behave like a detector. They constitutes another LC combination whose frequency can be varied by varying diameter. By varying diameter of this ring, we can set the LC circuit, which is to receive particular frequencied waves or signals released from this system. And then due to high voltage at their at air, due to high voltage, the air in the small gap between the spheres gets ionized. In the sense that air will become the conductor of charges. This provides the path for discharge of the plates. A spark begins to pass between the spheres. And in this diagram, you can see this is said to be spark region. Here, this is spark region. Whenever high voltages are given to S1 and S2, there is a large potential difference creates between these two spheres. And due to this large potential difference, this air between these two will become ionized, means the air will become the conductor of charges. That's why that charge passes from S1 to S2 or S2 to S1 according to their charges, positive to negative. Then there is a spark created. That is nothing but an electromagnetic wave. So now let us discuss how electromagnetic wave is produced. Because in the previous slide we discussed here, there should be an accelerating charge to produce electromagnetic wave. And the same is taking place in this experiment. Whenever that charge is traveling from S1 to S2, there is the charge is moving with some acceleration, that is accelerating charge. That accelerating charge can produce electromagnetic wave. A very high frequency oscillations of charge occur on the plates. This results in high frequency oscillating electric field in the vertical gap, nothing but in the spark region. Consequently, an oscillating metallic field, magnetic field of the same frequency is set up in the horizontal plates, plane, and perpendicular to the gap between the spheres. So whenever that charge is transferring from S1 to S2, there is happening that charge is accelerating, and due to that there is electromagnetic wave released here. These oscillating electric and magnetic fields constitute electromagnetic waves. The electromagnetic waves produced are radiated from the spark gap. The detector is held in a position such that the magnetic field produced by the oscillating current is perpendicular to the plane of the coil. The resultant electric field induced by the oscillating magnetic field causes ionization of air in the gap between the spheres. So a conducting path becomes available for the induced current to flow across the gap. This causes sparks to appear at the narrow gap. It was observed that the spark was most intense when the spheres S1 S2 and S1 S2 dash were parallel to each other. This was clear evidence of the polarization of the electromagnetic waves. So Hedge, by using this experiment, Hedge is identified the presence of electromagnetic wave. Here Hedge was able to produce electromagnetic wave of wavelength nearly 6 meters. After 7 years, J.C. Bose succeeded in producing the electromagnetic wave of wavelength ranging from 25 millimeters to 5 millimeters. So by depending on Hedge experiment, J.C. Bose also carried on the experiments to generate the electromagnetic waves. So this is about the sources of electromagnetic waves, and the experimenter carried on to know, to identify the electromagnetic wave. Next, let us see the types of electromagnetic waves and their applications. There are many types of electromagnetic waves, and they have their identical uses industrially, medically, and science and technology. So now let us have a close look towards the different kinds of electromagnetic waves, and also their applications in our life. So first one is radio wave. Range of lambda stands for wavelength of this radio wave, a few kilometers to 0.3 meter. So this is range of wavelength of radio wave. And range of frequency, V stands for here frequency, a few hertz to 10^9 hertz. 10^9 hertz. It means here this is the range of frequency, this is range of wavelength. According to the ranges of frequency and wavelength, their uses are there. Source, if you see the source of radio waves, is nothing but oscillating electronic circuits, maybe like LR circuits, and these are useful in radio and TV broadcasting. And the second type is microwave, and nowadays we are all very familiar with the microwave oven. It's a wavelength range from 0.3 meters to 10^-3 meter, which is nothing but millimeter. And their frequency ranges from 10^9 hertz to 3 × 10^11 hertz. Oscillating electronic circuits can produce this microwave, and these microwaves are useful in radar, analysis of fine details of atomic and molecular structures, microwave oven. And the next one, infrared radiations, IR, and they starts from 10^-3 meters of wavelength to 7.8 × 10^-7 meters of wavelength they have. And the ranges of their frequency is 3 × 10^11 hertz to 4 × 10^14. Their molecules and hard bodies can produce infrared radiations, and these infrared radiations are useful in industry and in medicine, astronomy, night vision devices, greenhouse, and revealing secret writings on ancient walls. Light or visible spectrum, this is also one of the kinds of electromagnetic wave, visible spectrum. So visible spectrum's range of wavelength is this one, 7.8 × 10^-7 meters to 3.8 × 10^-7 meters. Their frequency ranges are 4 × 10^14 hertz to 8 × 10^14 hertz, and these can be produced by the sources, atoms and molecules, when electrons are excited. And these visible light is useful in optics, optical instruments, vision, photography, etc. And another kind, ultraviolet rays, their range of wavelength is this one, 3.8 × 10^14 minus 7 meter to 6 into 10 power minus 10 meters, and their frequency range is this one. They can be produced by atoms and molecules in electrical discharges and sun, ultraviolet rays. And due to this ultraviolet rays released from the sun, there are many skin complications raised in humans or other living beings. There is a layer called ozone which protect our earth from the exposure of the ultraviolet rays. And these ultraviolet rays also useful in medical applications, sterilization, killing bacteria and germs in food stuff, detection of invisible writings. Next, forged documents, fingerprint, etc. Next kind of electromagnetic wave is the X-rays, and X-rays are of a range of wavelength 10 power minus 9 meters to 6 into 10 power minus 12 meters, and their range of frequency is 3 into 10 power 17 to 5 into 10 power 19 hertz. They can be produced by inner or more tightly bound electrons in atoms. And these X-rays are invented by the scientist Rontgen. And these X-rays are useful in X-ray photography to know the breaks or cracks of bones. Next, treatment of cancer, skin diseases, tumor, locating cracks and flaws in finishing metallic objects, detection of smuggled goods and bags of a person, study of crystal structures, etc. So in these areas we use this type of electromagnetic waves called X-rays. Next type is gamma rays, and gamma rays are with the wavelength which is not they overlap the upper limit of X-rays, means this limit is estimated. This limit may be some more than 10 power of less than 10 power of minus 14. But after the range of wavelength of X-rays, we consider that as gamma rays. Next, range of frequencies are this one, very high frequency. And radioactive substances are sources of gamma rays. And radioactive substances are those materials whose elements whose atomic number is more than 82, like uranium, radium. And they can self-emit this kind of rays called gamma rays. And these gamma rays can be used in information about the structure of nuclei, astronomical researches, etc. We use this gamma rays. So like this, there are many applications by electromagnetic waves. Like this. You can see this once again. Now I am going to close this session. Thank you.